Hallelujah. Amen. That's the Spirit of the Lord exhorting. Amen. Yeah, you know, Paul said in 1 Corinthians that when a spirit of prophecy begins to speak or a word from God, it's to encourage, it's to comfort, and it's to challenge us. Amen. Hallelujah. Anybody encouraged and comforted in that? Aren't you glad that the healer is here today? His healing is mine. You can say healing is mine. Praise God. I want you to lift your hands up to God right now and just believe you receive from Him right now. Father, we thank You. We praise You. We bless You. We give You glory and honor. And Lord, we receive that healing power, that healing anointing, Your grace and mercy flowing into our hearts and into our lives. Lord, You said healing was for our bodies, but You said peace and well-being would come into our minds and our beings. And Lord God, we thank You that You said You'd heal the broken hearts. We thank You, Lord God, there's healing for every hurt. And we just thank You for that healing anointing flowing right now. And Lord, we draw from the anointing. We draw from Your Spirit. We receive Your word in our hearts and in our lives this day. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Praise God. You can be seated. Hallelujah. Give me just a touch more here, please. Thank You, Lord. Amen. God wants us to be winners. God wants us to finish our course. He wants us to accomplish our faith. He wants us to be doers, but not just doers, completers of everything we put our hand to. Amen? In other words, God wants to bring us to full completion. How many of you believe God created you to win? See, you got to understand something. God never created anybody to fail or any situation for us to fail in. He wants us to win every battle and be overcomers, not only in this life, but in eternity. Praise God. So I want you to turn with me to Ecclesiastes chapter 7. Ecclesiastes, the 7th chapter, and verse 8. And I want you to see some things here in a verse that was written many, many years ago and that is still pertinent for us today. It's God's will today. In Ecclesiastes chapter 7, verse 8, the writer says, "Better is the end of a thing than the beginning thereof, and the patient in spirit is better than the proud in spirit." That's a good word for us, isn't it? Better is the end of a thing than the beginning thereof. How many of you found out that the end's much better than the beginning? The beginning may be exciting, but the end is where the reward's at. Nobody ever got a reward for starting. Amen? No, it's exciting standing there at the start line. It's exciting, and you feel the energy, and you feel excitement. But it's nothing compared to whenever you cross the finish line, and you obtain the prize, and you win the award. Praise God. So the end of a thing's better than the beginning. How many of you found out that healing's better than believing for healing? Amen? Sure it is. I mean, you pray for healing, but the healing is a whole lot better than the prayer for healing. And it's the same thing as getting your needs met. You know, you hear the word and you find out that God wants to supply all your needs, so you begin to pray. But you know what? Thank God you're excited because you found out the promise, but the promise and the excitement of finding out that you can have your needs met doesn't compare to whenever a check finally shows up and the bills are paid and you can stand there with all that pressure off of you. Amen? And see, that's exactly what he's saying here. You can take that in the small things of life or the daily things of life, but at the same time, you know, you can read the Bible and you'll find out that thank God for the day that Jesus came into your heart. What an exciting moment that was whenever you were cleansed from your sins, a new heart was placed into you, a new spirit came into you, and you became a child of God. But folks, I want to tell you what, as much as that is an exciting moment in our lives, I don't believe it can compare to the day when we stand before the Lord and see Him and reach out and touch Him. What a great day that's going to be when we end that race and we end in the presence of God. Amen? And you know, it's great starting off here on the earth. I mean, we get to get blessed, but you know, the Bible teaches us that even on our best day, we're operating in the earnest of our inheritance. Hallelujah. Now, an earnest isn't even the down payment. An earnest is, I'm putting this down to get you to hold it until I can go get the down payment. So as great as everything is that comes to us today, it's a small part to what it's going to be whenever this thing all comes to a conclusion. Praise God. So God is telling us here, get all excited about starting in faith. Get all excited about being healed. Get all excited about, you know, getting needs met and your prayers answered. But He says, don't just stop at the excitement of getting started. Look ahead and see the finished product. Praise God. Because the end of that battle, the end of that race, the end of that faith, the end of that believing God is going to be a whole lot better than it was when you first got started. Praise God. Amen? Then he goes on and he says this, the patient in spirit, the patient that are down in your spirit, down in your heart, down in your inner man is better than the proud in spirit or the hasty in spirit. Now, I looked up that word patient in the Hebrews, and it means long-suffering or slow to anger. So he says those that are long-suffering, those that are slow to anger, or we could say it like this, those who are not easily discouraged is better than those who are haughty and bragging all the time. Amen. Now, when I tie those two things together in that verse, I find this to be true. I find out for me to finish what I'm supposed to finish and accomplish what I'm supposed to accomplish, I cannot be easily discouraged. Amen? Now, that also tells me this. There could be some things out there trying to discourage me. Because if I'm going to stay patient, if I'm going to have to be not easily discouraged, if I'm going to have to be slow to anger and slow to quit and slow to give up and slow to let these problems come in, that means that I could be tested and tried before I get to the finish line. Anybody ever had that happen to you? Amen? See, the Bible teaches us that Jesus came to bring His life and came to bring His deliverance. He came to bring us everything that we need, but He also warned us in many different places throughout the Bible. In James chapter 4, He says, submit to God, resist the devil. That tells me that there are times that I'm going to have to stand against the attacks of the devil. Amen? In Mark chapter 4, Jesus teaches on the parable of the sower of the word. And He says, just as soon as He sows that word and it gets in the heart, here comes the devil trying to steal that word out of your heart. So He says there are going to be tests and trials. He's going to throw things at you to keep you from having the fullness of what that word means in your life. In 1 Peter chapter 5, Peter warns us and he says, over there that the devil is like a roaring lion roaming about seeking whom he may devour. And then he says, resist him steadfast in the faith. In other words, do not be easily discouraged. Do not find yourself getting aggravated and frustrated and throwing up your hands. No, stand your ground because there is a finish that you need to accomplish. Amen? There is something that you have to do. And today we need to understand that more than ever, we need to have this patience of spirit. We need to have this fortitude in us that we're going to finish what we put our hands to. We're going to run this race. We're going to accomplish what God called us to do. We're not going to backslide. See, I didn't get saved to backslide. The first little problem came along. And you know what? Nobody that's backslid today, not going to church, started off thinking, you know, I'm going to get saved for a few days and somebody's going to say something, I'm going to backslide. No, everybody was all excited when they first got saved. I've given my heart to Jesus, my sins are forgiven, and I'm going to live for God. And then here comes a little problem, here comes somebody, you know, that says something about you, here comes some disappointment, and the next thing you know, you're easily discouraged, and instead of finishing what you set out to do, now we can't find you. Because the enemy came in and stole the word out of your heart. But you see, when you get saved, you got to make up your mind, I'm not going to get saved till the first little problem comes along. I like what I've said it before, heard Brother Hagin say it before. He said, you know, somebody came up and said something about him. He said, what are you going to do about it? And Brother Hagin looked at him and said, you know, I've been persecuted by experts. I'm not going to let a little spurt bother me. Amen. And so, you know, we need to understand that we're not going to let a little spurt or an expert keep us from doing what God called us to do. And the enemy's an expert in trying to trip us up and keeping us from running the race that God wants us to run. So there are some things that we need to do if we're going to be a finisher. And I want you to look in Hebrews, the 12th chapter. Hebrews chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. And I want to give you about four keys here that God began to speak to my heart about helping us to finish. If you're going to finish anything, you need to have these things operating in your life. You need to be determined. You need to make up your mind that you're going to fulfill what God wants you to fulfill and have what God said you can have. Amen? And folks, the Bible teaches us in 1 Timothy chapter 6 that we're going to have to sometimes fight the good fight of faith, aren't we? What's that mean? That means you're going to have to fight through some things. You have to believe God for some things. Now, in Hebrews chapter 12, the apostle writing here to the church, the Hebrew church, says, wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which does so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. Then in verse 3 actually says, for consider him. You know, If you look at this, the apostle is writing to us, and he's telling us that we need to run this race, and we need to keep our eyes on Jesus, and we need to understand something, that even the Lord Jesus had to stand strong and not be easily discouraged to finish what he was going to do. Who for the shame of the cross he endured so that he could see the joy of finishing what he was sent to do. What was the course that Jesus came to do? He said, I've come to fulfill the will of my Father. Amen? He said, I've come to please him. I've come to do the works of God. And so the Lord Jesus, even in the garden, whenever he's praying, what? Three times he was tempted, tested, and tried to quit and not finish what he came to do. Remember, he prayed out and he cried out to God. He's under great pressure. And he says, Father, if there's any way this cup can pass from me. Remember him reading that? In other words, if there's any other way I can do this. But then he stopped and caught himself. He said, but not my will, but thine be done. What was he doing? He was consecrating himself to be a finisher. He was standing against the test and the trial that was coming against him. He was keeping himself consecrated and committed, even when it didn't feel right, even when it was hurting, even when it wasn't popular, even when it wasn't fun. Amen? Some people say, I'm not being happy being a Christian. What's happy have to do with being a Christian? Amen. Well, I thought I was supposed to be happy if I was supposed to be a Christian. No, you're supposed to be committed. And out of that commitment comes joy. And out of that joy comes happy. Hallelujah. But if you're just looking for happy all the time, you're not going to go very far, praise God. Because there are all kinds of opportunities to not be happy. Anybody found that out since you started living for the Lord? Because there's an enemy out there, and he's going to try to dissuade you and keep you from doing what God wants you to do. So there are four keys here, and the first one's found in verse 1. He says, wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses. Now, the Amplified reads it like this. Therefore, then, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses who have borne testimony to the truth. What's he talking about? He's referring back to Hebrews chapter 11, where he's talking about all these people who started off in faith and finished in faith. He's talking about people who went through battles. He's talking about people who lost their lives. He's talking about people who like Sarah and Abraham, stir themselves up to have faith to believe God to do what he said. He's talking about Moses, who had to make some consecrations. Do I stay with Pharaoh and enjoy the pleasures of sin, or do I consecrate myself and go do what God called me to do? Do I suffer a little bit to get the job done? He talks about Gideon and all the different ones who rose up against great odds and said, no, God said I can do this and I'm going to do it. And so they finished their course. And so the very first thing that you and I find is this. If we're going to be finishers, you need to find some biblical examples that you can follow. Hallelujah. And we might say it like this. Not only look in the Old Testament, but today, find you some scriptural, biblical examples of people who are doing what God called them to do and are living right. See, I could say it like this. In 1 Corinthians 15, he talks about over there, he says, wrong company corrupts good manners and morals. And so he's talking over there, meaning what? If you run with the wrong people, you're going to have the wrong things in your life. You show me today, you come and tell me who you look up to. Tell me who your hero is. Tell me who has influence in your life, and I'll show you the outcome of your life. If your hero is somebody out here in the world living every which way, you watch and see how they end up, because that's how you're going to end up. Because you're going to begin to emulate those who you look up to. You're going to emulate those who you admire. And so you need to make sure that whenever you're going to admire somebody or you're going to look up somebody, they better be the right somebody. And God tells us, consider that great cloud of witnesses. Look unto, see that great cloud of witnesses, those who have borne witness to the testimony of the Lord. Then look what he says in Hebrews the 6th chapter and verse 12. He says, that you be not slothful. Well, actually, let's read verses 11 and 12. He says, and we desire that every one of you do show the same diligence to the full assurance of the hope unto the end. Notice that God's always talking about getting to the end. And he says, we're asking every one of you to show diligence. We're asking every one of you to keep your hope before God unto the end. And then he says, here's how you do it. That you be not slothful, but be followers of them who through faith and patience inherit the promises. Look at that. You know something, folks? In our lives, we're faced with who we're going to follow. And everybody's going to follow somebody or follow things from somebody. Whenever I was young, I realized that I wanted to follow some people that had success in their life. And I prayed for God to lead me and guide me. And, you know, there were men in my life that I began to, in the spiritual realm, began to model myself after, began to follow after. One of them was Kenneth Hagin. I began to follow Brother Hagin, and I went to the school there because I wanted the anointing. I wanted the things he had in his life. I got to know Lester Sumrall, and I began to follow Brother Sumrall's teachings, and we had the great privilege of pressing in and getting to know him. And then, you know, I've told people, I read Smith Wigglesworth's books and heard so much about him and read so many of his miracles and so many of his teachings. He died back in the late 30s. Early 40s there, and I never knew him, but you know, I read his books and read his stuff so much that I could almost close my eyes and see him doing those miracles and raising the dead and doing the things that God called him to do, and I just built that into my life. And I begin to say, you know what, God, I'm going to show the same diligence to the end. I'm going to study the Word. I'm going to stay strong. I watched how they raised their kids, and I raised my kids similar. I began to watch how they conducted themselves under pressures and how they began to do things. And I began to say, Lord, show me and teach me these things. And they began to be patterns in my life. And you know what? I was very scriptural in doing so. Because you see, I go back and I read about Abraham. I read about Isaac. And I find out the mistakes they made. And I find out the great decisions they made. And I try to learn from them, praise God. I find out how Moses consecrated himself to God. And I find out also how he didn't deal with his anger. And it ended up keeping him from getting to the promised land. I read about Joshua and how Joshua had his insecurities when God told him to take over Moses' job. And Joshua got before God, and God said, here's how you take care of those insecurities. Meditate in my word day and night and be strong in me, and you'll be able to do what I've called you to do. And so Joshua gave himself to the word, and Joshua followed God. And Joshua still made mistakes. He got duped one time. Some people came in dressed up like they had old clothes on, and he made a deal with them. And they were right down the road, and they were supposed to be the enemies he was supposed to get rid of. And you read about it, and you get into the Bible, and you don't just read the Bible, but you find examples in there. And you find people you emulate, and you begin to model your life after, and you begin to see their strengths and their weaknesses. And you begin to grow from that. Look what Paul says over here in Philippians, the third chapter. Philippians chapter 3, he says, brethren, be followers together of me. That's pretty strong, isn't it? Be followers together of me, and mark them which walk so as you have us for an example. I want to ask you something today. Who's a spiritual influencer in your life? Ladies, what spiritual influence do you have in your life? What spiritual woman is helping to mentor your life and speak into you? Men, what spiritual mentors do you have? I mean, who are your spiritual fathers? Who are those that you see God in their life and you want to see that in your life, praise God? And listen to me, when you begin to follow somebody like Paul's talking, you mark them as examples, that doesn't mean you're going to think they're perfect and you're going to believe everything they believe. Listen, Kenneth E. Hagin was a tremendous spiritual father to me. He was tremendous in my life. And I loved him and adored him and followed his teachings and had great fellowship with him. And he was a great mentor to me. But you know what? I stand here today, and this doesn't do any discredit to him. I didn't agree 100% with everything that Brother Hagin said and did. But I agree with his life. I agree with his consecration. I agree with his love for Jesus. I agree with his walk in the Spirit. I agree with the example that he was before me. I don't expect people to agree to everything that I teach in this pulpit. You can be wrong about some things if you want to. But I do ask you to look at my life. I ask you to look at my marriage of 39 years. I ask you to look at my children. I ask you to look at their families. I ask you to look at their kids. I ask you to look at my home. I ask you to look at how I carry myself. I ask you to look how I conduct myself. And if it's a holy thing that you see, then it can be an example that you can follow. Do I want you to be me? No. Do I want you to know God like I do? I do. I want you to know Him better than I do. My purpose to not only help you, but to help you to get farther than I can get, praise God. And you see, we begin to mark these. And Paul says this, you have these as an example. For many, now look what he says, here's the warning. For many walk, of whom I have told you often and now tell you weeping, that they're enemies of the cross of Christ, whose end is destruction, whose God is their belly, and whose glory is in their shame, who mind earthly things. What's he saying? He's saying there are some people out here that were marking God's people as examples and serving God and reading the Word, but then they got hooked up with the wrong crowd and they got pulled back into the world, and their belly, that means their flesh, their natural appetites for ungodly things pulled them away from God. And now they're in destruction today because they're running after the wrong crowd looking for the wrong thing, and they're not finishing what God sent them out to do. Paul says here in Philippians chapter 4, verse 9, those things which you have both learned and received and heard, now here's the important one, and seen in me, do. In other words, it's not enough just to hear it or to receive somebody. You know, Jesus is teaching to the disciples, and he came up to them one day and he said, listen, he said, do what the Pharisees are telling you to do because their teachings are right, but don't act like them because they're hypocrites. They won't lift one finger to help anybody else do anything. Paul said, don't just do this because you've heard it out of my mouth. Don't just do it because you receive it as truth, but do it because you've seen it in me. And know this, that if you'll do these things yourself and apply these words to yourself, then you will have the same results with God that I've had. Hallelujah. See, folks, here's the thing. I don't get upset whenever I find a minister who is walking in integrity, walking in the anointing of God. And I don't know why I'm off on this, but I'm going to stay with it for a moment. I don't get upset because I see success in a pastor or success in a minister. Because, you see, if he's acting on the Word, speaking the Word, living the Word, doing the Word, and God's blessing him because he's consecrated to him, then I'm not going to fuss at him. I'm going to make him an example that I can follow, because I know God's not a respecter of persons. And if the Word's working for that guy, the Word will work for me too. Hallelujah. And if I'll do what he said to do and do what I see him do, then God will do for me what he's doing for him or her. Hallelujah. Amen. Because I make him an example. Paul said in 1 Corinthians 11:1, follow me as I follow Christ. You quit following Christ, I quit following you. But as you follow Christ and you become a godly example, then I want that in my life. So Paul says the very first key to you finishing your course, have you some godly examples. Find you some godly mentors. Find you some people that know how to speak into you. Find you some people that are winning some races. Find you some people that are successful. Find you some finishers, praise God. See, I'm not one much to follow a starter. I've never modeled my life in any area of my life after a starter. I've modeled my life after finishers. If I was going to go run a marathon, I would not go find someone who teaches on running marathons, who never ran a marathon. He would have had to run one, finished well, and then I could find out how he did it and what he did so I could do it in my life. Amen. Are you hearing me? Because people's philosophies without personal experience will get you no victories. But the Word of God, tried and proven, lived out, will cause your life to be changed and transformed by the power of God. So number one, Hebrews chapter 12, what are we going to do? I'm going to find me a godly example. I'm going to model my life after someone who is living for God, not some crazy character out here that's seeking form and fortune. Amen? Fame and fortune. Now, number two, Hebrews chapter 12, verse 1. Let's go back over here. Look what he says. He says, not only are we surrounded by a great cloud of witness, let us lay aside every weight and every sin which does so easily beset us. Now, the Amplified says right here, let us strip off and throw aside every encumbrance, unnecessary weight, and that sin which so readily, deftly, and cleverly clings to and entangles us. So what's the second thing? Get rid of any weight or sin that is hindering you from running your race. It's not worth carrying around. Get rid of it. Strip yourself from things that are holding you back and keeping you in doubt, unbelief, and failure. Amen? Romans, the 8th chapter, the Apostle Paul gives us great instruction over here. In Romans, the 8th chapter, he tells us in verses 12 and 13, it reads like this. He says, Therefore, brethren, we are debtors not to the flesh to live after the flesh. What's he mean? He says, you don't owe your flesh anything. and you don't owe others anything. What do you mean? Well, some of y'all's weights could be the people you're running around with. You're hanging out with the wrong crowd. You're going to the wrong places. Yeah, but I ought to be there. You don't owe them nothing. I don't owe you anything if you're going to take me to hell. I don't owe you anything if you're going to get me out of church. I don't owe you anything if you're going to get me back in drugs. I don't owe you anything if you're going to get me away from God. Uh-uh. I'm not going to do that. I don't owe that to you. I've been bought with a price. I belong to Jesus. If I owe anybody anything, it's Jesus. Amen. And I'm going to have to be willing to strip away some things. And look what he says. For as many as are led. Now, in verse 13, it says, for if we live after the flesh, you shall die. Look at that. If I let my flesh dominate me, what did he say in Philippians 3? He said they turned away from God, turned from following God, and they began to do their own thing. And he said it brought them destruction when they made their belly, their appetites for the world, their God. So he says, if you live after the flesh, you're going to die. So what am I going to do, Paul? He says this, but if you through the Spirit do mortify or put to death the evil deeds prompted by your body, you shall live. Hallelujah. What do I need to do? How do I get rid of these weights and these sins and these things that you know, Paul said in Romans 7, I want to do right. But every time I want to do right, I end up doing wrong. And he says, I find in my heart the desire to do what is right, but I find in my flesh this other thing that's pulling me away. And the good that I would, I don't do. And the bad that I don't want to do, I end up doing. Oh, wretched man. Who's going to save me from this body of death? Who's going to deliver me from this life of in and out and up and down? And I want to win, but I end up losing. I want to be nice, but end up being mean. I want to say good things, but end up saying bad things. I want to go to the right place, end up in the wrong place. How am I going to get free from that? Oh, wretched man, who is going to deliver me? He says, thank God through Jesus Christ, my Lord. Hallelujah. You want to get rid of some of these things that are hindering you? Make Jesus your Lord. Get filled with the Holy Ghost. And then say, Holy Ghost, I want to put you to work in my life. Some of you got filled with the Holy Ghost and just put him in the guest room. You need to get filled with the Holy Ghost and put him in the workout room. Hallelujah. And say, Holy Ghost, guess what? Me and you have some things we need to get done here. We need to get rid of some of this junk out of my life. And I need you to help me to put to death some of these evil lusts and desires and the things that have held me back and keep me from winning all the time. And Holy Ghost, I'm asking you right now to help me to rise up and be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. Hallelujah. And begin to walk in the Spirit and let the Holy Spirit help you to live this life. Because you see, you're a finisher. You're not just a starter. You have to win this thing, not just to run this thing. Amen? And so you ask the Holy Spirit to help you. In Mark's gospel, you don't have to turn there, but Mark chapter 9, in verses 43 through 47, the Lord Jesus is teaching. He says, listen, he said, if your hand is doing the wrong thing, it'd be better to cut it off and enter into the kingdom of God with one hand than have two. He said, if your feet are taking you to the wrong place, it'd be better to chop off one and go into the kingdom with one foot and not have two and go to hell. He said, if your eyes keep taking you the wrong way, he said, it'd be better to pluck them out and go in the kingdom of heaven with one eye than to go to hell with two. Somebody said, well, I never did understand what Jesus was teaching there. Did you notice that Jesus, in teaching this, he starts off with the hand, then he goes to the foot, then he goes to the eye. Amen? Hand, foot, and eye. What's he talking about? He's not talking about chopping your hand off or cutting your foot off or plucking your eye. He's talking to you and he's saying this. If what you're doing with your hands is a hindrance to you, quit doing it. He said if your feet are taking you to the wrong places, like down to the bar, to the drug house, to the people that hate God and want to live wild, to the parties. If your feet take you there, stop letting them take you. Tell your feet, we aren't going there anymore. Quit going there. And if your eye keeps looking at things that are pulling you away, you keep lusting. If you're a man, you're lusting after this. And a woman, if you're lusting after that. And it keeps pulling you away. And instead of looking to Jesus, you're looking at the problem all the time. He says, ask the Holy Spirit to help you to quit looking at that. See, there are places you're going to have to quit going if you're going to be a finisher. And you can't listen to the lie of the devil. Well, you can go and witness to them. No, you won't. You go and get drunk with them. Until it's dead in your life, you don't have any place with it. If it's still on life support, it can come back. You don't deal with it. I mean, you know, folks, this is the thing. Well, you know, I feel obligated to go tell them about Jesus. They'll tell you what you do. Pray that the Lord of harvest will send laborers across their path that are already delivered. And you go do what you need to do. Because I'm not going to let anything hinder me. Listen to me, folks. That might mean you're going to have to get delivered from some friends. And you're definitely going to have to get delivered from their opinions. And you have to make up your mind how you're going to do and what you're going to do and where you're going to go and what are you going to look at. So number two, you're going to have to ask the Holy Spirit to help you to get rid of some things out of your life that keep hindering you and keeping you from finishing. Number three is found in verse 1 of chapter 12 of Hebrews, and it says this: let us run the race with patience that is set before us. Let us run with patience this race. Everybody needs to run their own race. Do you hear me? You need to submit to what God has called you to do. Every race is important. Nobody's race, nobody's place is more important than yours. And yours is not any more important than theirs. Amen? God has laid out a race for each and every one of us. Actually, in the Amplified, it reads like this: and let us run with patient endurance and steady and active persistence the appointed course of the race that is set before us. Hallelujah. See, God has a special thing for you to do, a special race for you to run, a special calling for you to fulfill. God wants to do great and mighty things in your life. But you see, in 2 Corinthians 10:12, he says that it's foolishness for us to compare ourselves with everybody else. He says when you start comparing yourself with somebody else, you're not wise. Why? Because you see, if I start comparing myself with you, you'll look better than me. Every time. You'll always look better. I mean, you know, we go look at somebody, and they're in here, and it took every ounce of faith I had just to get up and come to church this morning. Everything in me wanted to stay home. Everything in me wanted to just quit. Everything in me thought, nobody cares. Nobody knows what I'm going through. I've had it. I don't want to go to church. Have you ever noticed when you're feeling like that, and you make a decision to stay home? That was the service that the message was just for you. You know, you maybe think maybe the devil knows what message the preacher was getting ready for on Sunday morning. And that's why it was so hard for you to get up that morning, because he didn't want you to hear it. So the next time you're sitting there, I'm not going. Remember and let my voice be speaking to you. This message was for you. But you come in and you just, I mean, it took everything in you to get here. And you look over and there's somebody sitting there and they're going, hallelujah, hallelujah. And you go, see, God, look how great they're having it. Why me? It's foolish to do that because, see, you don't know the battles that they went through and why they're standing there doing it. Maybe they went through worse than you, and they just decided, you know what, I can either complain and grump and cry and leave my head, or I can just praise God and act like Jesus is Lord. And maybe they just made a decision to praise God right through the battle, and instead of you thinking they don't have a problem, you ought to say, you know what, if they can praise God, and I know they're going through something, because everybody's going through something, and everybody's being tempted and tested and tried, and everybody's being stopped by something, so they just decided they are not going to let their walls determine their direction. Come on, when the children of Israel came into Canaan's land, the very first thing they faced was walls they couldn't get over, couldn't get around, and it was going to determine whether they had anything or they didn't have anything. And instead of grumbling and complaining, they obeyed God, shouted the victory, and God brought it down. Folks, there are times that the devil's going to throw things in your path that this looks like it's impossible to get through. It's there to stop you from finishing what God wants you to finish and having what God wants you to have, and you're going to have to make up your mind at that moment. I'm not going to look and see what anybody else is doing. I'm not going to care what anybody else is going through. I'm going to focus in on Jesus. And right now, I'm going to praise God and not be refused to have what God said I can have. Because the moment you look at somebody else, you'll think, oh, they're spiritual and I'm unspiritual. All these thoughts of how unworthy you are will come into your mind, and how bad you've got it will come into your mind. So what do you need to do? You just need to take your eyes, put them on Jesus, lift your hands, say, praise God. I'm going to praise the Lord anyway.
I'm going to praise God and thank him anyway. Paul spoke to the Romans, and he said over there in Romans chapter 11, around verse 13, he said, I'm an apostle to the Gentiles. I magnify my ministry and office. You know what he's saying there? He's saying, I'm so excited doing what God called me to do, I don't have time to compare with everybody else. I'm just excited about serving God myself. I'm excited about living for God myself. I'm just excited. Listen, I'll help you, praise God, but I can't stop and grumble with you. I can't stop and complain with you. I can't stop and backslide with you. Come on, get up and let's go on to church. Hallelujah. And I'm going to just walk with God. And you see, here's the thing. Paul writes in 1 Corinthians 9, he said, everybody's out here running a race, but only one receives a prize. He says, to run to obtain, run to win. And he says, and they that are running this race and running to finish and running to get to the finish line, he says, I'm going to tell you what they are. They're self-controlled in the areas of their life that they need to be. They put themselves in God's hands and say, Lord, help me. Help me to get through this thing. Help me to run this race. And then they begin to look at this. You know what? My race is important. My course is important to run and to finish. Because, see, you start comparing what you're doing for God and what somebody else is doing for God, and sometimes it looks like yours is very insignificant. Well, who am I? They're real spiritual. I mean, God's really using them. They've got a real valuable ministry. They don't need me. They wouldn't miss me. But, you see, in God's eyes, every race is important. Every work is important, and you're important. And it's important in God's eyes for you to finish. It's important in God's eyes for you to fulfill what he wants you to do. It's important in God's eyes for you to run this race and do what God's called you to do. And finally, the fourth one is found in Hebrews chapter 12, verse 2. And he says, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. You know what you need to do? You're going to have to make up your mind today. You're going to keep your eyes on Jesus. Because I'm going to tell you what, best friends sometimes will let you down. Come on. The best intentioned Christians will sometimes let you down. Not meaning to. Come on. Sometimes, unfortunately, the best ministers and the best churches can let you down. Something can get through that then maybe something you're going through and nobody knew. Sometimes you can come to church and you're going through a battle and you just make up your mind you're going to live for God, and you'll sit right beside the person you shouldn't have sat beside. It's like they were planted right there. And they aggravate you the whole service. Or they say something to you that absolutely makes you want to pull your gun out that you hid because you just got your carry permit. I'm just kidding. And you go like, God. That's when you have to look unto Jesus. That's when you have to look beyond people. Because, see, you can't judge people for their faults because you got faults too. You can't judge people because they're having a bad day because you have bad days too. You can't judge people because they weren't sensitive because there are days you weren't sensitive too. So what do you have to do in those times when the enemy's trying to surround you? Take your eyes off the enemy and put them on Jesus. And you start saying, Lord, I thank you that you're not only the author or the beginner of my faith, but you're the developer and the finisher of my faith. And for me to get to the finish, I got to keep my eyes on you. Can't let anything get my eyes off of Jesus. Can't let anybody get my eyes off of Jesus. And the next time I feel like I'm unimportant, I need to realize that's the devil trying to steal because I am important. And you know, Lord, I need to be in church, not just because I need to be in church, but you know, I bet there's somebody else there today that needs to be encouraged. Amen. By me making a good decision to live for you is going to help them to make a decision to keep living for you too. Amen. And you know what? There are people that are out here that don't go to church that are looking to you. You know, the world right now is looking for all kinds of examples to follow. They're looking everywhere. They're trying to find somebody that's real. They're not trying to find somebody that's perfect. They're trying to find somebody that's real. And the message I'm preaching to you this morning is not to get you perfect. is to get you real. It's to get you ready and to get you to understand that this is a real race. There are real problems. There are real things you're going to have to do. And to finish it, you're going to have to get submitted to God and say, Lord, help me. Help me to clean up what I need to clean up. Help me to not be easily discouraged. Help me, Lord God, to fight through when it gets tough. And Lord, help me to keep my eyes on the finish line. Help me to get there. You know, here's the thing. I've shared this story a lot of times. And here's why you come to church. You come to church for this reason. Whenever I was in high school, I ran track as well as play football. And so, you know, I had some speed and had some endurance and different things. So I ran a variety of things. And so we were in the state meet, and I ran the shuttle hurdles, and I ran the anchor leg on the shuttle hurdles, and we got fifth in the state, and so pretty good. And so then, you know, I had to run the half mile. I ended up getting second in the state, and so, you know, that was pretty good. But it was about 90-degree day early spring there before school's out, and after I finished that, and we had to go straight from that to the mile relay, and we qualified, you know, to get in that, and so I was the anchor man on the mile relay, and so I'm thinking, I'm dying. So I'm trying to find a place to hide so they maybe can put somebody else in my place and let them run. Because I'm done. I'm finished. I'm out of here. And so I heard the coach, and he tells a couple of guys, says, listen, if you're going to get a place in the state, there you better get him up off, you know, because I'm over under a tree, you know. And so they come over and throw water on me. They drag me back into the restroom area and where the sinks are, and they're spraying water on my arms. And so because a coach from Huntington, he was legend, praise God. He came over and he said, listen, take him in there and put ice water on his arms. He said, those are the closest veins to the heart. That'll help him recover quick. So these guys are doing everything. So I kind of finally get up and we start, and I'm thinking, well, the first guy's pretty fast on our team, but the two middle guys will be so far out of it. I'll just run around the track, finish, we'll be done. Because I'm tired. And so the first guy runs and we're up in the top five. Second guy runs and we're in the top five. Third guy runs and we're in the top five. And I'm going, oh my God, they're not quitting this time. They're running. And so they hand me the baton and I take off on the last leg and I go down and I'm coming around the first curve and I'm fatigued. And here goes these two guys running by me, which takes me out of fifth to seventh. Seventh place does not get a medal. And they're talking when they go by me. I'm thinking, I'm dying here. And they're running by talking and laughing at each other. So I picked up the pace, and I'm running. I'm within close, you know, I'm stayed up with them. I'm thinking, I'll never catch these guys. I'm never going to get there. What the coach had done is he'd gotten all the track team, put them up in the corner of the final curve. You come through the curve down that last straight to the finish line. And I didn't know they were there. And I'm running. I'm just like in a daze. You know, as Christians, sometimes we can kind of get in a zone. We're kind of dazed. We're not running to win anymore. We're just kind of running, going through the motions. That's how I was. I wasn't thinking about winning. I was just thinking about, can I get to the finish line? I don't even know if I can finish. I'm dying here. And I'm just thinking all these thoughts like, oh, God. You know, and so I'm running. About that time, all the team in unison, just out of the blue, didn't know what was going to happen. They go, now, Hoffman, run! And they screamed like their lives depended on it. It scared me so bad. Then when they yelled, I just took off running, man. I'm slinging arms. I went into a dead sprint, passed the guys in the curve, and almost caught the guy in front of us. Hallelujah. We got in the medals, praise God, the top. And I found out, you know what, there was a whole lot more in me than I thought I had. But it took that group encouraging me to find it. That's why you need to have godly examples. That's why you need to have a church home. That's why you need to have people that will encourage you, because there are times that you're in a zone and you need to be able to go to church and have a group of people and a minister stand up and say, you can finish this. Run. Don't quit. Keep your eyes on Jesus. Don't let the devil stop you. You're better than that. And you can dig down on the inside of you. You can walk out of here saying, you know what? Jesus is my Lord. I am born again. I am a child of God. My sins are in the past. I am a new creation in Christ Jesus. Old things are passed away. All things are become new. And I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. And I'm going to finish this thing. I'm going to finish this. I'm going to get there, praise God. I'm going to have what God said I can have. I'm going to do what God said I can do. And I'm going to let Jesus do a great and mighty work in my life. That's what this is all about, folks. Being a finisher. It takes all of this if we're going to be a finisher. Nobody is an island to themselves. Everybody needs to have some help. Amen? Amen. So don't set yourself up to be a failure. Set yourself up to be a winner and a finisher in the Lord Jesus Christ. Let's pray.